left off with the study of DNA structure, and we left we had mentioned the aesthetic beauty of the molecule, and indeed it is a pretty molecule, and part of its prettiness, part of its aesthetic beauty comes from the way that structure of the molecule allows for its replication with fidelity, and you heard them discussing that feature in that movie clip. And Watson and Crick, in their paper which described the structure of DNA, immediately recognized that the molecule provides a means for its accurate reproduction in taking a parental molecule and producing two daughter molecules, which would be the requirement of the genetic material. And that replication process could be described as semi-conservative, in that, given the complementarity of the bases in opposite strands of a double helix, if the strands separated, so we separate these blue strands here, and then build gray strands upon each blue strand, using the base pair complementarity to build a strand which is complementary to the original strand in its base pair sequence, A's paired with T's, G's paired with C's, then you would end up with two daughter molecules that were identical in the nucleotide sequence to the parental molecule. Now, Watson and Crick immediately realized that this would be a very effective means for replication of the double helix. But formally, there were other possibilities. You could imagine, although mechanistically a little bit difficult to imagine, but you could say that a parental DNA molecule remains and an entire new double helix is synthesized somehow using the information present in the original double helix to produce an identical daughter double helix. Or you could imagine that would be a conservative model of replication. Or you can imagine a dispersive model of replication in which parts of the daughter molecules, the daughter double helices, would be parts of each strand would be synthesized anew, and parts would be remain from the original parental helix. But this semi-conservative model in which one of the parental strands is completely conserved in each daughter and has served as a template upon which to synthesize a daughter strands, this model seemed most appealing. And Meselson and Stahl did a very famous experiment, one of the best experiments I think in all of molecular biology, in which they demonstrated that Watson and Crick's proposed semi-conservative model of DNA replication was in fact correct. So here's what they did. They labeled they used bacteria, E. coli, the human gut bacterium, and they could grow those bacteria in liquid medium that contained the heavy isotope of nitrogen, N15. And then that would label their DNA, because of the nitrogenous bases, that would label their DNA with heavy nitrogen. And they could then switch the E. coli to a medium which contained the normal isotope of nitrogen, is not radioactively labeled, and the bacteria would, as they progressed and replicated, they would then incorporate light nitrogen into the nitrogenous bases and therefore into their DNA. And then they could take the samples out of this culture in which heavy labeled DNA or bacteria containing a DNA labeled with the heavy isotope of nitrogen was transferred to a medium which contained the light isotope of nitrogen. They could take samples at various times and centrifuge isolate DNA and centrifuge that DNA in an ultracentrifuge at very high speeds. And at those high speeds, you can separate out molecules that have greater mass than other molecules. So completely labeled DNA would sediment more towards the bottom of their centrifuge tube than would completely light DNA. So they could then determine with the positions of the sedimentation of DNA molecules in bacteria that were sampled at various times after they had been transferred to the light medium. And they could detect the labeled DNA by exposing the centrifuge tubes to a photographic film and determine this banding pattern, which describes the position of labeled radioactive DNA. So at time zero, as soon as you transfer the bacteria into this new medium, they still have labeled heavy DNA. Both strands of a double helix would be labeled with radioactive nitrogen, with N15. And indeed, if we go top to bottom, we're put the to centrifuge tubes now horizontally, here's top and here's bottom. Indeed, the heavily labeled DNA at time zero produces a single band that sediments towards the bottom of the centrifuge tube. But after one round of DNA replication, what you find is another single band of labeled DNA, but this sediments at a position that would correspond to a lighter double helix, a double helix with less mass than the double helix that would have both strands labeled. And this strongly implied that after one generation, one round of DNA replication, in other words, that there was one type of DNA double helix produced, which was a hybrid between light, newly synthesized DNA and parental labeled DNA that had the N15 isotope. So we detect the label at a position that it sediments at a higher position in the centrifuge tube than fully labeled DNA. Excuse me. And after two generations, after two rounds of DNA replication, they observed two bands containing radioactive DNA. One was, well, actually this is not labeled DNA. They are detecting all DNA here. They're putting a dye in their tubes that allows them to visualize DNA, all DNA. And after two rounds of replication, what you find is a hybrid band here and a completely light band of DNA. And this makes perfect sense if you consider the semi-conservative model of DNA replication. After one round, you should have hybrid molecules. And after two rounds, when this molecule that is hybrid, that is, has one parental heavily labeled strand and one completely new light strand, when that molecule replicates in the light medium, in bacteria within the light medium, then the light strand shown in gold here would serve as a template upon which to synthesize a new unlabeled strand. Whereas the original strand of DNA that came from the parent here would be, in fact, the template upon which a new unlabeled strand would be synthesized, and therefore we would have a hybrid band of DNA. And that is exactly what we see here, our two bands. So the Meselson and Stahl experiment then was an elegant way to show that the semi-conservative model of replication was most likely the correct one. You will note that after one generation, the hybrid molecule predicted by the semi-conservative model of replication produces one completely heavy strand and one completely light strand. Now, you would have obtained a hybrid density molecule if the dispersive model were correct. After one generation, you would have hybrid molecules that would have density intermediate between completely light DNA and completely heavy DNA. But if you consider what the dispersive model would produce in the next generation, since every strand here is a hybrid between labeled and unlabeled DNA, in the next generation you would still have hybrid molecules. You would not have a completely light double helix produced at generation 2 using the dispersive model. So their results in the second generation confirm that the semi-conservative model is the correct model, in that that if each parental strand is serving as the template upon which new daughters are synthesized, then this hybrid molecule in the semi-conservative mode would produce another hybrid molecule in the second generation and one completely unlabeled molecule. And after Watson and Crick and Meselson and Stahl solved the structure of DNA and then showed that semi-conservative replication was the mode of DNA replication, it soon became not obvious, but it was soon discovered, I should say, that replication of bacterial chromosomes proceeded bidirectionally from an origin to a termination point about 180 degrees opposite on the bacterial circular chromosome. So here we have two strands of DNA indicated in purple here, and we schematically show that there are two directions of replication emanating from the origin of replication, and new daughter strands are being built up, shown in red, using the template information present in the parental purple strands in both directions. There's bidirectional replication, in other words. And we refer to each of these points of replication, one moving in this direction and one moving in that direction, we refer to these as replication forks. So these are the replication forks. And in a bacterial chromosome, the replication forks proceed around with the enzymatic structures required to synthesize DNA. There are enzymes, of course, responsible for the synthesis of new DNA strands, that is, the polymerization of nucleotides into new strands of DNA in each direction, and those enzyme complexes proceed around the chromosome until the termination point, ultimately yielding then two molecules, each of which contains a completely conserved parental strand in purple and a completely newly synthesized strand shown in red. Now, bacterial chromosomes are relatively small compared to eukaryotic chromosomes, and as we've seen, bacterial chromosomes are circular. Eukaryotic chromosomes are linear, not circular. And if we look at the replication of eukaryotic chromosomes, here is shown a electron micrograph of replication in a eukaryotic chromosome, and what I'm circling here are replication forks. And these replication forks are proceeding bidirectionally from what were points of origin, somewhere in the middle here. So here is a replication fork proceeding bidirectionally, and there is another one, and here's another one, and there are more as well. As we can interpret this electron micrograph as follows, that we have multiple replication forks, rather, and I'm circling them now, and these replication forks then are proceeding bidirectionally. This means that eukaryotic chromosomes have multiple sites of origins of DNA replication. There are multiple origins of DNA replication in a eukaryotic chromosome, many hundreds in cases of long chromosomes. And as in bacteria, the replication proceeds bidirectionally from a given origin of replication. Now, in the next part of this lecture, we're going to examine what happens at the replication fork, kind of the enzymology of DNA replication, and look at the way that new nucleotides are inserted into growing strands of DNA built up from the information present in the parental strands of DNA, and the way that new daughter double helices are produced.